Good day. I'm Norman Wildberger, and today we're going to talk more about circles. In fact, we're going to discuss parametrizing the points that lie on circles. Now, our approach to geometry is to work entirely within the rational number framework. This is the simplest and most natural arena in which to do geometry. Later on, when we get a little bit more sophisticated arithmetically, we'll talk about extension fields and introduce irrational numbers as well. But it's important to realize that the essential features are already here when we're just looking at the rational number field. In fact, many interesting relationships between geometry and arithmetic are obscured if we go too quickly to higher fields, for example, the so-called real numbers. Number theory and geometry are naturally linked, as we're going to see today when we talk about points on circles. A circle for us is an equation like this: x minus a squared plus y minus b squared equals k. The point AB is called the center of the circle. The number k, which can be completely arbitrary, is called the quadrants of the circle. We usually denote a circle with a little curly c. Here is the equation of the circle written out. And we can express that by concretely listing the coefficients of x squared, xy, y squared, x, y, and the constant term in a list. This proportion of six coefficients effectively captures what a circle is, and in fact, that's how we defined officially what a circle was. The question we want to talk about today is, when does a point x, y lie on such a circle, and which points lie on such a circle? It's made simpler by the observation that if x and y satisfy this equation, then x minus a and y minus b satisfy this somewhat simpler equation, x squared plus y squared equals k. And since going from xy to x minus a, y minus b is simply a shift, we can, without loss of generality, restrict ourselves to simpler circles of this kind, circles whose center is at the origin. So let's have a look at the simplest possible circle, the unit circle, with equation x squared plus y squared equals 1. There it is there with center 0, 0, and it goes through the points 1, 0, 0, 1, minus 1, 0, and 0, minus 1. But it actually goes through a lot of other points as well. How do we get those other points? Well, you may remember that 3, 4, 5 triangle is a right triangle. So 3 this way, 4 this way, 5 hypotenuse, that's a right triangle. That's telling us that 3 squared plus 4 squared equals 5 squared. And if you divide by 5 squared, you get that 3 over 5 all squared plus 4 over 5 all squared equals 1. So the point 3 fifths, 4 fifths is also a point on the unit circle, and it comes from Pythagorean triple. And that's a general kind of phenomena, which is captured by this theorem. Every point on this circle, with the exception of minus 1, 0, can be written in this following form: 1 minus t squared over 1 plus t squared, 2t over 1 plus t squared. When t is 0, we're here. When t is 1, we are here. When t is minus 1, we are here. And as t gets bigger and bigger, we approach this point. When t becomes a bigger and bigger negative number, we approach this point from the opposite direction. Naturally connected with this parametrization is this identity, or this relation, that if you take 1 minus t squared and square it, and take 2t and square it, and you add them, then you get exactly 1 plus t squared, all squared. This rational parametrization of a circle, of the unit circle, is very useful and important. And for many applications involving circle geometry, it's preferable to the more usual, familiar parametrization involving the transcendental circular functions cosine and sine. The problem with this parametrization is that it's almost never accurate. If you actually want an example of a number of a point like this, you plug into your calculator, It spews out some answers to 10 decimal places or whatever, and you get a point which is approximately on the circle, but not exactly on the circle. This parameterization, we're still dealing in 100% accuracy, which is what we want, because we want to do mathematics completely correctly. Now let's see how this result, this parameterization of the unit circle, extends to a more general circle. Now let's have a look at the general circle with the equation x squared plus y squared equals k. We'll assume that there's at least one point on the circle, say a, b, so that a squared plus b squared equals k. Then there's at least these other points, minus a minus b, minus ba and b minus a, which are also on that circle. How do we parameterize the points on this circle? Well, it's a little bit different, a little bit more complicated, but it's the same generalized idea as for the unit circle. Every point on this circle, with the exception of this minus a minus b, can be written uniquely in this form. X-coordinate a times 1 minus t squared minus b times 2t, all over 1 plus t squared. And y-coordinate a times 2t plus b times 1 minus t squared, all over 1 plus t squared. So that's a theorem that follows in a similar way as does the previous one. It gives a complete parameterization of a general circle. One of the interesting features about geometry with circles is that a line through the origin, or the center, does not necessarily have to meet the circle. Whether it does so or not depends on number theoretical considerations. And so we get a link between geometry, very simple geometry, and classical problems in number theory that have been around for thousands of years, that were studied by Euclid, that were studied by Fermat and his contemporaries. So the situation in general here, with the circle of the form x squared plus y squared equals k, and a line through the origin of the form ax plus by equals 0, is that the line meets the circle precisely when this number theoretic condition is satisfied. When a squared plus b squared times k is a square. When we say it's a square, we mean that it's a number, a rational number r, squared. And so this line L may or may not meet a circle through the center there. So this is a little bit of a different aspect of circles than you're used to when you deal with real numbers. With real numbers, a lot of arithmetical subtlety vanishes from geometry. So one of our aims is to bring back this natural number theoretical aspect of geometry into elementary geometry also. In our next video, we're going to have a look at another important concept from elementary geometry, the idea of a vector. I hope you're going to join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger, and thanks for listening.